Hi everyone, really many of you here, so thank you for showing up. So I am Aurimas, I am a Chief Product Officer at Neptune AI, and today I want to talk a little bit about observability in LLMOps platform, in LLMOps pipeline, and more specifically focusing on the places in LLMOps pipeline that actually benefit from the infrastructure scale. And it's not infrastructure scale in, you know, GPUs you're using to train the models, but actually the infra you need to observe your systems and why it is valuable. Okay, so the value chain of LLMOps, very simple. Everyone probably knows about it now by now because we're in a AI engineering world sphere, right? So we have pre-training, so training of the foundation model. Then we move to reinforcement learning with human feedback. Then we fine-tune the model. So these two things together are called post-training and fine-tuning. Then we do some prompt engineering. Sometimes we apply some retrieval augmented generation techniques on top of it. Then we move to some a little bit more complex systems, agentic systems, and eventually agentic networks. So each of these pieces of LLMOps pipeline require different scale of observability tooling in order to, you know, bring results and kind of be valuable for you in your pipeline. So this is pretty much how it looks like, the graph of what scale you need at each of the steps. So you would see that at the very beginning, pre-training and RLHF, you need a little bit more of observability infrastructure. And, you know, this is about observing your training. So we are used to think of observability in production, but in these new times when we are kind of training our models on these huge clusters, there's also now observability in the training and not only in the production applications. And once we move later down the stages and reach RAG agent systems, the scale increases, continues to increase. So we are somewhat here today, so I don't think that we are yet properly figured out how to actually productionalize and train agentic systems, but I guess that by the end of the year we'll be pretty good at it. So that's why it's worth to think about the needs of observability scale today. And in the end of 2025, I think we'll be somewhere in the middle of adopting agentic network systems, so basically building networks of agents. Now today I want to double click into specifically pre-training and RLHF, as well as RAG systems, agents, and agentic networks, and see why do we need and what kind of scale of observability tooling we need there, and what value it brings for us, so how much money we can save, and why would we even save the money by investing in those observability pieces of the infrastructure. So let's start from pre-training, so foundational models. So there are several factors that play in this together when it comes to pre-training. So we have a huge GPU clusters naturally that we need to train the models. Then we have model size, which has dramatically increased throughout the time. And we have a time needed to train the model of this size, of this quality. Now, let's start with GPU clusters, right? So we have a GPU cluster, it functions well, and then once it starts moving through time, we start running into distributed system problems, like it's proper system engineering, it will break, right? It's really not possible to avoid. So once it starts breaking, we need to restart it, so restart our training runs, and we start losing money, right? So each restart might take us back a day or maybe sometimes few hours, but if we think of the time it takes to train a foundational model, and we kind of had a very nice talk by a researcher from Mistral today, so we are training on sometimes from 10 to even 10,000 GPU clusters for up to month, 2 months, or 3 months of time. So you can imagine if we are spending on this training job like 500 million or similar amount of dollars, restarting one day back might cause you a, let's say, a few million dollars in damage. So as you continue training, the failures continue to occur, and then you kind of are losing money continuously as the training time progresses. Now, in combination with this, we also have the model size, which is increasing naturally. And this kind of causes paranoia, right? So because we are losing so much money, we want to observe our systems very, very accurately. And when we want to do that accurately, we want to track everything. So we want to track all of the internal layers of the large language model. We want to track multiple metrics, something that that is common, something that you have derived, and we want to save everything in our model tracking system. So number of tracked parameters correlates very much with the actual size of the models, which is pretty obvious. But then we have some additional needs from some of the bigger companies that are training models. So for example, what we might also want is to track metrics not aggregated in the controller of the actual trainer, but rather track metrics per GPU, right? So you can imagine if you're training one on 1,000 GPUs, you might want to track 1,000 more data points compared to what you would usually do. And this is not like, this is not a fiction, right? Some companies really want to do that, and for different reasons, either for optimizing something in your GPU stack, or just being sure that everything is tracked, and then you can find why stuff is happening in your system once you have your GPUs breaking. Okay, so that was pre-training. So you need to spend money on observing pre-training, because if you don't, then you will lose a lot of bucks just because you are restarting your models, let's say, one day back, or even several hours into the past. Now, when it comes to reinforcement learning with human feedback, we also have seen similar diagrams quite many times, probably, where you first do supervised tuning, then you train a reward model, and eventually you use that to kind of give feedback while you train the original model. And also from the same talk that I heard today by Mistral, there was a very great example in numbers given. So these types of training kind of cost around 10 times less than the training of the pre-training of foundational models themselves, right? So they are taking a little bit less time, so usually days rather than months. Plus, you are not running on 1,000 or 10,000 GPUs. You're usually okay with 100 GPUs. So naturally, these cost less. So if it costs less, then of course you are not that inclined to spend that much money on the actual observability tooling and infrastructure itself to support all of the scale that you need. You probably don't want to track metrics per GPU. You're okay to track everything that is kind of aggregated in the controller. So it's fine, right? But still, very high cost of observability infrastructure scale. The next one is just regular fine-tuning. So you already have your foundational models ready, your instruction-tuned models ready, tuned to also human feedback, and this is cheap, right? So this is, you don't want to invest much here, because you can really probably go with even 10 less scale when it comes to GPUs needed and time needed to fine-tune on your small data sets, where you only have very, you know, limited amount of data that you can fine-tune on compared to what you can get from reinforcement learning from human feedback. So this is fine, like you don't need to spend a lot of money on observability infra in these stages. Next, let's move to some a little bit more complex retrieval augmented generation system. So I will present a very naive version of it, because it's not about the complexity of the system itself, but what you want to do while observing it, and what the cost infrastructure is. So I'll try to derive some conclusions from it. So very, very naive system. We have a controller that manages the retrieval and the generation kind of pieces of your system. And we want what we want, actually want to do with this, we pretty much know well already. So we want to track the traces. So what's happening in your system? And the traces is just combination of multiple events that are happening while you perform your retrieval augmented generation in production, right? So following the green arrows, first we want to track the embedding procedure. Did it succeed? How much time it took for the query to be embedded? How many tokens in the query? How fast the embedding was performed and similar. Next, we want to go and retrieve the data from our vector databases, so also tracking. Usually, it would also include tracking the vectors, both retrieved and embedded, to be kind of used for a nearest neighbor search, because maybe in the future you want to analyze what happened here if something unintentional happened. And the final one is the actual construction of the query with the context that you have retrieved from your vector databases, constructing the prompt, passing it to LLM, and seeing how much time it took, how much tokens was passed into the LLM, how much data was returned, how fast it worked, etc. So all of the path, all the combination of these events, the trace is kind of highlighted in green color here. So this is what we want to track. So in ideal world, we don't really care if the system succeeded in retrieving the data you want, if the answer was of a good quality enough. So we are really usually interested in the failure points. So we can have a failure point at the retrieval phase where we are trying to retrieve a specific vector from our database. Or the most important, we can try and indicate the quality of the final retrieved answer by evaluating the answer constructed by your retrieval augmented generation system. Now, in ideal world, we could just filter that out and just observe, so basically store in our observability systems the traces that were kind of evaluated to be not great, right? The problem with this is that usually we are still relying on things like using other LLMs for evaluating your answers. So it's not really easy to do that in real time, especially when your application is constructed in a single process and when you don't want to slow down your application. So the only, at this moment in time, maybe it will change, the only kind of proper way to do it is basically store all of the traces in your internal systems and analyze and evaluate them when they are already kind of in your databases. So a scale requirement here comes from specifically this. If you could filter out only the kind of low quality results and only store them, it would not be a scale issue. Now, when it comes to engines, it's very similar. Like if we have a retrieval augmented generation system, we simply rename the retrieval piece to knowledge. We kind of move the LLM into the center of the picture. We move the controller and use next to the LLM and use LLM to also create the intent of your system, not rely on controller itself. So you have the agent core. Oh, sorry. Yes, you have an agent core. You add long memory, and long memory is very similar to RAG. So you could imagine you just copy paste the RAG, but instead of internal knowledge, you just store conversation history in there with some additional more complicated or less complicated strategies of retrieving it. We add tool capabilities, we add instruction sets, and we have ourselves an agent. And in order to properly observe the agent, you want to observe all of the kind of, it's still a trace, right? And anything that is happening inside of those quadrants, either it's knowledge, long memory, tool usage, or instructions. So you still need to observe everything that's happening inside of it and the communication of the core between these quadrants. So it's basically just, you know, quadruple the amount of data that you actually want to store. So it's a very large, I would say, increase in scale compared to just regular retrieval augmented generation systems. And then finally, we have the agentic networks. And in agentic networks, we just, you know, kind of slap a bunch of these agents together, connect them into a graph, and either allow them to do specific actions according to their own intent to kind of perform specific actions, or we also can allow a user to interact with one of the nodes and then trigger some action for the agents to solve. Now, this is pretty complicated. This becomes pretty complicated because now we are moving into a distributed system. Again, one additional layer of distributed systems, almost like microservices, where an agent is a microservice of a sorts. So we need to also track a trace between agents. So like the most obvious thing to do would be to kind of send unique identifiers as a session tokens between them, and then kind of store everything in your databases, and then you can connect everything via these unique IDs, right? And then you get a very, very long trace. But it's quite an error-prone procedure, and we know that we have... So this is already speculation, right? How it will be done. I don't know. Like, I assume that this is one way of doing it. I also know that from regular software engineering and distributed systems, we have data meshes like, not data meshes, sorry, service meshes like Istio, etc. So we would have a proxy gateways before each agent, and we have additional kind of layer mounted on top of the agent kind of API endpoints through which we communicate, right? So all of this unique ID passing happens not manually by you, but basically it is implemented inside of these communication proxies between each other. But in general, like a very complicated system to track. If you want to really store all of the traces of it, it's a huge amount of data. And it's not only a huge amount of data in general, it needs to be searchable, it needs to be explorable. So you will probably want to tag certain actions so that you can then filter according to them, because just data by itself is not that useful. So you need some context on top of it. So I would say that like these systems will be very, very, very hard on infrastructure to, especially if you want to implement them properly. So yeah, looking back at this graph, we kind of touched upon each of the steps apart from prompt engineering, but because in prompt engineering, it's, you know, pretty easy. You just do some prompts, combinations of prompts and answers plus the model used, and then you can choose the best ones to kind of deploy to production. So Neptune AI, now some shameless plug of our product. We are focusing on solving the first three steps. So we rebuilt our product from foundation to support really, really massive amount of scale when it comes to ingesting of metrics while training your model. And on top of that, we are doing that in a very like robust way so that you never lose data. You will always be able to see any data point that could be anomalous or not. So very performant. We are based at the Booth G8. So if you want to see what we are cooking, please come over. We also have a demo to showcase the scale that I'm talking about. We also give out coconuts. So feel free to jump by and get one for yourself. And this is what I wanted to talk about today. And thank you for attendance.